Now, in this series, I'm shooting all of the cat RCs for you and putting up an RC a day. But you might have come across this RC before on this YouTube channel. And that's because this RC is more important from a strategic perspective. Slot 2 was widely considered to be the toughest slot in Cat 23. But even there, we had a couple of easier RCs. This one and the one which I solved yesterday. In case if you haven't done that, just make sure to solve that first because that's a little bit easier than this. And that is how you should structure your mocks as well. And your cat as well, starting with the easiest first. And also putting in some time to choose the easier or the more doable cases, RCs, questions, and so on. And if you're wanting to work on your test taking strategy, then you can sign up for our mock pack. But if you want to target a high percentile in CAT and you want to prep with 99.9 plus percentilers, then currently our self-prep pack and our crash course are very affordably priced. In the self-prep pack, you get access to all of the video lessons, practice questions, mocks, as well as the live test taking strategy for every mock. And in the crash course, you get all of this. And along with that, you typically get about 4 to 5 classes every week, if not more. And on top of it, you will also get access to Vignesh and me for mentorship and guidance. So what are you waiting for? Now let's start with this RC. Make sure that you've paused the video and solve the RC first. If you're doing it on mockcat.com, of course, you have the RC to your left. And if you're watching this on YouTube, I'll put the link in the description and the first pinned comment so you can try out the RC first. So now let's start with the passage. Umberto Eco, an Italian writer, was right when he said, "The language of Europe is translation. Netflix and other deep-pocketed global firms speak it well." Just as the EU employs a small army of translators and interpreters to turn intricate laws or impassioned speeches of Romanian MEPs into the EU's 24 official languages, so do the likes of Netflix. It now offers dubbing in 34 languages and subtitling in a few more. So what's Umberto Eco saying? He's saying the language of Europe is translation. Now, translation is obviously not literally a language, but when you think in terms of Europe or even in terms of the EU, right, there's so many languages, right? There's English, French, Belgian, German, Spanish, Italian, and so on. So what the governments are doing or what the EU is doing, the same thing now Netflix and other, probably other OTT platforms or other any other global firms which have deep pockets, which have a lot of money, are also doing it. So Europe, or I'll just put EU over here, right? They have many languages, and that's something which Netflix has definitely adapted. I'll just put it as Netflix Plus, so other firms are also doing it, where in case of Netflix, they have dubbing and subtitles in multiple languages. So from here, we can also infer that Netflix is probably giving a lot of importance to the EU and is also managing it well, right? Because it's dubbing and, you know, providing subtitles in so many languages. By the way, from a CAT perspective, verbal perspective, as well as from a VAT PI perspective, make sure that, you know, you're aware of the European Union, what's happened, even Brexit and things like that, because these are things which definitely frequently come up and these are things which you will want to know as a manager. The economics of European productions are more appealing too. So a lot of times the first sentence of every paragraph is going to tell us what that paragraph is about. So while we've understood that Netflix is providing a lot of dubbing and subtitles, now we understand that there are European productions. They're also producing shows in Europe, and that is making sense economically or financially. American audiences are more willing than before to give dubbed or subtitled viewing a chance. This means shows such as Lupin, a French crime caper on Netflix, can become global hits. So American audiences, we can obviously, you know, understand that probably the American audience is one of the largest audiences in Netflix, given that Netflix is American. So they are willing to, they are more and more willing now to watch content in other languages, which is maybe, you know, being dubbed in English or where there are subtitles. So they've given an example of Lupin. I can also think of Money Heist, Dark. There are multiple shows which are there. And I think the same happens in India, right? There are a lot of different language shows which we watch where maybe, you know, they're dubbed or maybe they have subtitles. In 2015, about 75% of Netflix's original content was American. Now the figure is half. So we don't need to go into the numbers of it per se unless we have a question or an option. But what we know is that Netflix's original content is now more and more less American, and probably a lot of it is now coming from Europe or coming from EU countries. Netflix has about 100 productions underway in Europe, which is more than big public broadcasters in France or Germany. So more than, you know, the public broadcasters. So take something like a Doordarshan here in India, right? So way more than that is being brought out by Netflix. So EU has many languages. Netflix, not only are they providing their content in many languages, what they're also doing is they're also coming up with European shows. And they're actually coming up with a lot of European shows. And these shows actually can become global hits because American audiences are willing to watch shows which are dubbed and or have subtitles. Not everything works across borders. Again, this is important. So not all types of shows are going to work out. Comedy sometimes struggles. Whodunits and bloodthirsty maelstroms between arch Romans and uppity tribesmen have a more universal appeal. Now, we do have a question on what could work or what could not work. So let me quickly note down what works and what doesn't work. So whodunits, which are essentially, you know, murder stories, those work, as well as bloodthirsty maelstroms. So I'll just put it as violent shows, right? Violent shows or violent fights. These are things which work. What doesn't work could be comedy. Some do it better than others. Barbarians aside, German television is not always built for export, says one executive, being polite. So what is for export? Probably people in other countries across Europe are not watching it. So comedy might not work, and a lot of times German shows, aside from, you know, maybe some of these violent shows about barbarians and all, those work. Other than that, they typically don't. A bigger problem, so this is obviously, you know, one problem that some shows may work and some may not work. Another problem, an even bigger problem, is that national broadcasters still dominate. Streaming services such as Netflix or Disney Plus account for about a third of all viewing hours, even in markets where they are well established. Europe is an aging continent. The generation of teens staring at phones is outnumbered by their elders who prefer to gawp at the box. Now, the box probably refers to the idiot box, which is another word for the TV, right? If you don't know it, it's something which you can still try and infer, or at least understand that, okay, for some reason, there's not as much of, you know, Netflix or other OTT being viewed as compared to TV, or as compared to national broadcasters. Even that you could use, thinking that, okay, national broadcasters, where would they come? They'd probably come on TV. So this is one problem. Another problem which we have is the national broadcasters are more popular. So Netflix as well as OTT, let me probably just put this in a bit of a box. So it is less popular than national broadcasters, or I'll just put it as national media. One reason is because Europe is an aging continent. So the older people, they actually prefer TV. In Brussels and national capitals, the prospect of Netflix as a cultural hegemon is seen as a threat. So from an EU perspective, as well as from every country perspective, so take capitals like London or Paris or Rome and all, they are considering, or they are looking at Netflix as a threat. They feel that if Netflix gains cultural dominance, if it becomes number one platform that people view, they are looking at that as a threat. So this is from the perspective of the countries themselves. So far, we've been reading from Netflix's perspective. We were looking at, you know, what makes financial sense, what people are watching and so on. And, you know, what are the issues that they have. Now we come to the other side where we are understanding about the countries themselves. Cultural sovereignty is the watchword of European executives worried that the Americans will eat their lunch. So what it means is they want their own culture to dominate. So sovereignty, they want their culture, their programs to dominate. They are worried that the Americans will come and take away their revenue or take away their profits. To be fair, Netflix content sometimes seems stuck in an uncanny valley somewhere in the mid-Atlantic with local quirks stripped out. So from the EU perspective, they are looking at Netflix as a threat. Now this could be from a cultural perspective or this could be from a revenue perspective. They are focusing on their culture as well. At the same time, the author is saying that Netflix doesn't have too many of the local cultural aspects or the quirks. Netflix originals tend to have fewer specific cultural references than shows produced by domestic rivals. So when you have local, OTT, they will have certain cultural aspects which the Netflix originals don't. The company used to have an imperial mode of commissioning with executives in Los Angeles cooking up ideas French people might like. Now Netflix has offices across Europe, but ultimately the big decisions rest with American executives. This makes European politicians nervous. So less local culture, and the important decisions are still made in the US. So the EU looks at Netflix as a threat. they don't want Netflix to dominate. At the same time, they also don't like that Netflix shows, they don't have many of the cultural aspects, and the decision making, at least, you know, the major decision making is still there in the US. That is what makes them nervous. That is what makes the European politicians nervous. And then the author gives us their view and says they should not be. So this they has to refer to European politicians. So right now, European politicians are nervous, but the author is telling us that they should not be, which means that they should not be looking at Netflix as a threat. An irony of European integration is that it is often American companies that facilitate it. Google Translate makes European newspapers comprehensible, even if a little clunky, for the continent's non-politics. American social media companies make it easier for Europeans to talk politics across borders. Now Netflix and Friends, probably other OTT, pump the same content into homes across the continent, making culture a cross-border endeavor too. So a lot of the times, European integration, or, you know, European countries coming together, maybe I look at it from the EU perspective, the EU countries coming together, is something which is enabled by a lot of American companies such as Google, social media companies, and so on. And Netflix is trying to do the same thing, because Netflix is sharing the same content across all the European countries. That is also making culture a cross-border endeavor. What does that mean? Everyone is sort of having access to the same shows, the same media. So culturally, everybody is coming together. Everybody is sort of getting integrated a bit more. If Europeans are to share a currency, bail each other out in terms of financial need, and share vaccines in a pandemic, then they need to have something in common, even if it is just binging on the same shows. So again, I think this Europeans here is given from the perspective of the EU, because all of the EU countries, they have the euro, which is the common currency. They also do have flexible, you know, open borders and all. They do bail each other out in terms of financial need. So if one of the European countries, one of the EU countries is not doing well, the other countries will sort of come together to help it. And probably COVID vaccines also they look to share. So there's a lot of sharing and openness that is there within the EU countries. But the author is saying for that to happen, for people to be okay for that to happen, then they need to have something in common. And that something in common can very well be something which I would say is more basic, like watching the same series. So Netflix, far from being a threat, Netflix is actually something which will end up uniting the Europeans, or integrating, as the author said, the Europeans culturally. And how culturally? We are not speaking about them, you know, going and watching the same art, or, you know, something like that. Just by watching the same shows, they sort of come together. So this is essentially the author's view. Watching fictitious northern and southern Europeans tear each other apart 2000 years ago beats doing so in reality. So probably again the author is speaking about those violent shows and all, saying that if everybody is watching it at the same time, that is much better than actually fighting, right? So net what the author is saying is Netflix is trying to be more and more successful in Europe. It's focusing more and more on Europe. There are a lot of European productions which are there, and even American productions. They're all, there's, you know, they're available in multiple languages by way of dubbing, subtitles, and so on. It's being accepted by the American viewers, but the European politicians are a little nervous about it. While Netflix is still not number one in Europe by any means, they have to figure out what content works. There are people who are watching TV. The national broadcasters are the ones that are dominating. Yet, to the extent that Netflix is doing or has come about in Europe, that's making European politicians nervous. They want to preserve their own culture. But the author is saying, hey, that's wrong. The author is saying Netflix can very well do what Google and some other companies did, where they actually enabled European countries coming together, and Netflix can do the same thing. Culturally, they can bring the EU citizens together. And that is something which is necessary, because these countries are doing a lot of things together. They have a common currency. They're bailing each other out in terms of a crisis, they're sharing resources and so on. So this ends up becoming the primary author's view. So now, based on that, for the second question, we need to find a positive option. The author sees the rise of Netflix in Europe as, now we know that the author feels that Netflix will actually help to unite people living in the EU from a cultural perspective. So we're looking for something like that. Now we have a couple of positive options. One is a unifying source, and the other force, and the other is filling an entertainment gap. A unifying force is much closer, right? When we are saying uniting EU culturally, while we don't have the word culturally, we still have uniting or unifying. So this definitely has to be the answer. Filling an entertainment gap is more at a more I would say trivial or a less important level. We are speaking about uniting people across countries, whereas this is still stuck at that, you know, watching shows level. So we can eliminate it. We can also eliminate the other two options because they are more negative. A looming cultural threat is something which the author is not seeing. It is politicians who are seeing. Politicians are nervous about the rise of Europe. So it's for questions like these and for eliminating options like these, which to some extent are given in the passage, figuring out the author's point of view becomes very important. So if you want to know more about it, I'll link a video that I've shot here. And you can also head on to mockat.com, where there are a lot of solved examples where I've gone through articles and found the author's point of view across multiple different genres. And we also share a daily reading link and the author's POV, which I prepare. I think right now on the site, they're close to 400 articles already. So along with that, you can even if you want to do more, you can also try to do like a couple of articles every day and so on. And if you really want to get deep into it and, you know, you want to get a really high score in verbal as well as in CAT, then you can sign up at mockat.com and prep with 99.9 plus percentile. So as I was saying, we eliminate a looming cultural threat because that's maybe politician's view and not the author's view. And same thing for the fourth option as well. Both of these are not the author's view. So we'll eliminate them and go for the first option. Now, while the final paragraph is fresh in our memory, we can also quickly solve the third question. Which one of the following research findings would weaken the author's conclusion in the final paragraph? And as we were just discussing, the author's conclusion is that Netflix, like other American companies, can actually help to unite people living in the EU because they need that, right? When they are coming together and they have a common currency, they're helping each other out and so on, they need to be unified. And culturally, one way could be by watching the same show. So we're looking for something which will weaken this. Now we'll primarily focus on the Netflix aspect as opposed to some of these other companies like Google and social media companies, because that definitely would weaken the author's conclusion more because the entire passage is about Netflix. Research shows that Netflix has been gradually losing market share to other streaming TV service providers. Now this is definitely weakening, but what it's weakening is the initial parts, right? Initially we knew that, you know, Netflix is focusing a lot on Europe and, you know, there are people are watching shows and things like that. So it's not very relevant to the last paragraph. Having said that, obviously if people are not watching Netflix shows, then somewhere it definitely becomes tougher to unite. So we'll sort of park this option and see if there's something better. And option two is actually better. Research shows there's a wide variance in the popularity and viewing of Netflix shows across different EU countries. Now if everybody across different countries are viewing different shows, how on earth are they going to get united? The author is saying that they need to have something in common, even if it is binging on the same series. So if everybody is watching different series, like, you know, people in Italy are watching something, people in Germany, something else, people in France, something else, and so on, how are they going to come together? So now we can eliminate the first option because the second option is really weakening the author's conclusion. So this ideally should be the right answer. Research shows that older women across the EU enjoy watching romantic comedies on Netflix while younger women prefer historical fiction dramas. Now this also is weakening because, you know, we are splitting women or females into two groups where older women watch one sort of show and younger women prefer another set of show. Now I'm not going into the fact that, you know, the author told us that comedy sometimes doesn't work, because again that's not relevant to this last paragraph. But if you see, when we say there is a wide variance in the popularity and viewing across countries, that is showing way more difference than just saying that, you know, half of the women prefer one type of show and half of the women prefer another type of show. Because if this is the case, older women across the EU can still sort of like, you know, unite over some specific series, and the same thing can happen for younger women as well, right? So this is weakening, but option two is weakening more, so we can eliminate it. And again, something which directly flows from the author's view. Research shows that Netflix hits produced in France are very popular with North American audiences. This is something which is in line with the passage, and it's also referring to something which is given closer to the beginning of the passage. So I will eliminate it because it's not weakening at all and definitely not weakening this part. So we'll go for the second option here. So now let's look to solve the first question. Based on information provided in the passage, all of the following are true except. So this is what I call a direct multiple question. Three out of these four options would be true based on the passage, which means that they would be given in the passage. We cannot look for exact words. A lot of times we will have synonyms and all. That's just the nature of CAT. So you need to really understand the passage, even though it's a direct question. But then three of these will be given in the passage. We eliminate it. Whatever's left becomes the answer. Why? All of the following are true except. So you got to find three. Now that makes these questions a little bit lengthier, but I definitely recommend that for direct multiple questions, go back to the passage and check, because you're not going to remember the entire 500 or so words from an RC. So instead of making a mistake, if you take 10-15 seconds more and you get it right, instead of a minus one, you're getting three. So that's 4 marks extra. So let's look at the options. European TV productions have the potential to become global hits. This is something which, you know, I myself have written out here, and it's something which is given here, right? American audiences are more willing than before to give dubbed or subtitled viewing a chance. Economics are more appealing and they're willing to give it a chance. So, you know, this is, for example, a French show which can become global hits. So this is something which we can infer from the passage, and hence we eliminate it. Only half of Netflix's original programming in the EU is now produced in America. So this is also something which, luckily for us, is given in the same paragraph. In 2015, about 75% of Netflix's original content was American. Now the figure is half. So what does that mean? About 50% of Netflix's content is now American. Now, if 50% of Netflix's original content is American, or original programming, both are essentially the same thing. So that counts for Netflix's content globally, Netflix's content in the US, in Europe, in India, and so on, right? Nowhere have been told that, you know, Netflix is selectively showing some shows somewhere or something like that. So don't get confused with this part. This is definitely something which we can infer from this. National broadcasters dominate in the EU in terms of total television viewing hours. This is also something which we've written down here, that Netflix and other OTT, their share is less than national broadcasters. That's something that's given here. A bigger problem is that national broadcasters still dominate. These guys are accounting only for a third. So all streaming services are accounting for only a third, right? So this is the one. It is anyway something which is directly given. So you can eliminate it. And that leaves us with the fourth option. And that we can see at a glance itself that it's wrong. Netflix has been able to transform itself into a truly European entity. Now, they've again been kind to us, right? The term truly is what helps us to eliminate. We know that, yes, Netflix is focusing on Europe. They have, you know, European production, a lot of, you know, shows. They are dubbing into European languages and so on. But it's not truly European because they are still making decisions in the US. And even the, you know, the local cultural quirks or aspects are things which are missed out. So this definitely is the right answer here. And now coming to the fourth question, this is again an inferential question. Based only on information provided in the passage, which one of the following hypothetical Netflix shows would be most successful with audiences across the EU? So which of these four shows will probably be most successful? Now, it is because of this question that when I was reading this part, I actually wrote these down. So what will work are whodunits or, you know, murders. So, you know, you have these murder mysteries. And we also have these historical violent shows, right? So there was something about a bloody, bloodthirsty maelstroms between arch Romans and uppity tribesmen. So these are the things which will work. What might not work is comedy and German shows, aside from something like this. So let's look at the options and find either one or both of these. A transatlantic romantic drama set in Europe and America. We have no idea whether romantic dramas will work or not. There's nothing mentioned about romance out here. An original German TV science fiction production. We know for sure that German TV is something which doesn't work, so we can eliminate it. We've been told that German television is not always built for export. A murder mystery drama set in North Africa and France. A murder mystery is something which will definitely work. We've been told that whodunits have a more universal appeal. Now, there's a bit of vocabulary over here, of course. You need to know what whodunits are, but let me go through the fourth option and I'll tell you how to infer it as well. An Italian comedy show hosted by an international star. So this international star set in North Africa, set in Europe and America and all is just there to add red herrings, to confuse us or to waste our time when we start thinking of different countries. The point here is comedy is something which may or may not work. So again, we can eliminate it. And now that you know that 2 and 4 are for sure not given, then you could either directly look at, hey, there's a crime caper which has become a global hit. Since it's become a global hit, it'll probably be popular in EU also. So that way you could say this is the closest. Or what's an even better way to infer? See, you have whodunits and bloodthirsty maelstroms, right? Now, when you have a murder mystery and you have a romantic drama, a whodunit, you could still say, okay, if there's a murder mystery, who has done it? Who has killed, you know, the person that's murdered, right? That is more likely than, I mean, this term, it's more likely that it's describing a murder mystery drama than a romantic drama. So that is one way in which you could also think, even if you don't know the term, right? And a lot of times when it comes to RCEs or when it comes to articles, right, hopefully you're reading my daily reading link and comparing your POV with mine. So a lot of times there will be these unknown words and these unknown concepts that we essentially don't know. So what I would recommend is make sure you Google the meaning, you review all of the meanings which are there. You could just say, for example, you want to know the meaning of the word whodunit, you can can just go to Google and type define who done it and you'll get the meaning. You can try to get it in English as well as your native language if that is something which helps. And I would recommend, if possible, write it down if you have the time for it. And use resources like, you know, the speed vocab that you have at mockat.com. And there are a bunch of apps and a bunch of websites where you can test your vocabulary. But contextual learning like this is something which makes sure that, you know, it stays in your mind. I generally don't recommend, you know, looking to memorize word lists, because then, you know, it's going to take a lot of time and you won't remember as much. But after reading this, if you didn't know the meaning, it's unlikely that you'll forget the meaning of who done it, because we have discussed it so much, right? So that's something which you can try out. So now coming back to this, option three becomes the right answer over here. Now you could have a doubt, how am I sure that this is about the EU, right? This entire paragraph. So that is something which we understand from this. Not everything works across borders. So when we are saying across borders, right? So border is in plural. So if it was about the US, they would have said something like, not everything works across the Atlantic, right? Or in the US. Across borders, especially in plural, has to signify the European countries, right? So that is something which you can infer. Another thing you can think of is, even in an inferential question, while the answer is not given, there's definitely something given in the passage which will help you understand. And while whodunits to murder mystery is something which is a very clear link, even a French crime caper is something which could lead you to this. Now, this is something which I usually don't recommend, because this is straightforward there. So it's much better to infer that borders is what is taking us to Europe and use that to select. So that's it for this RC. And if you want to prep with 99.9 plus percentiles and you want to get a high CAT score, then what are you waiting for? Sign up at mockat.com right away.